Good afternoon, everyone. You're very welcome to our event today, Let's Step Up, Holding Companies to Account for Harming People on the Planet, as part of the One World Festival. My name is Jeannie McCann. I'm going to be the moderator. Unfortunately, Clodagh Rice is unable to join us. I am Trocaire's Campaigns Officer in Northern Ireland, and I'm also part of the Organising Committee of the One World Festival. We've had some fantastic talks, exhibitions and film screenings this week on the theme of working together for a more just, peaceful and sustainable world. Many are still available to watch back on the website. Today is the last day of the festival, but we're still going strong. We're delighted to join you for this discussion on corporate accountability, which is organised by Christian Aid, Frontline Defenders and Trocaire. As consumers, when we buy groceries, new clothes, use electricity, or go about our day-to-day lives, we want to ensure that we're not having a negative impact on others. Yet, as we will hear, some companies have a profound negative impact on people and the environment around the world, including some with links to the UK and Ireland. Soon, we'll hear from Gary Walsh from Trocaire and Hannah Story from Frontline Defenders. There'll be time at the end for lots of questions, but you don't have to wait for then to ask your questions. Drop them into the chat in whatever platform you're watching this on, and we'll leave plenty of time to get to them towards the end of our discussion. But first, we hear from Rosa María Mateus Parra, who's an activist from Colombia, who's on the front line, peacefully resisting the actions of irresponsible business. Rosa is involved in a lawyers collective, which is a partner of Christian Aid. The collective supports Indigenous communities to peacefully resist the Cerrejon mine, which is the largest opencast coal mine in Latin America. The mine has a long and well-documented history of serious human rights abuses. Rosa supports and accompanies communities to defend their rights and territories. Earlier, Rosa spoke to my colleague Diva Thomas from Christian Aid.
My name's David Thomas and I work for Christian Aid Ireland, and we've been working with partner organisations in Colombia for many years to support communities in claiming their rights, and particularly the right to land. And also we've been supporting partners who are holding the state to account to make it more responsive to civil society and to protect human rights defenders. So it's great to speak to one of our partners today, and I'm going to ask you first if you could introduce yourself and tell us a bit more about your role working with Cajar.
Hola, un saludo para todos y todas. Mi nombre es Rosa María Mateus. Yo soy abogada en el colectivo de abogados José Alvear Restrepo. Coordino el eje de defensa del territorio y lucha contra la crisis climática. Y soy la responsable de acompañar a varias comunidades de pueblos indígenas, afro y campesinos en la defensa de su territorio. Somos una organización defensora de derechos humanos, del ambiente y el territorio.
The event today is particularly focused on exploring some of the negative impacts that corporations are having on human rights around the world. And I know that alongside Christian Aid and other organizations, you've been working specifically on the case of the Cerrejon mine, which is the largest open cast coal mine in Latin America and is based in Northern Colombia. And it's a mine that's been implicated in a whole list of serious human rights abuses and environmental disasters. Could you tell me what some of those human rights abuses are, and also how Cajar got first involved in supporting communities to raise their concerns?
Bueno, a través de los años, nosotros hemos recibido solicitudes de las comunidades para junto con ellos estar en una ruta de exigibilidad de derechos. Y hemos logrado corroborar las graves situaciones que se presentan. Hay afectaciones y daños desde todos los niveles, desde la salud, desde el ambiente sano, desde los derechos, por supuesto, territoriales, culturales. Y en efecto, junto a varias organizaciones y también un trabajo conjunto con Christian Aid, hemos logrado llevar a cabo varias acciones jurídicas, de incidencia, de comunicaciones y de fortalecimiento organizativo que han permitido develar las situaciones que se presentan. Frente a este caso, nos encontramos en unos abusos de poder, unas asimetrías enormes que, por supuesto, afectan a comunidades, sobre todo al pueblo Wayuu, quienes, por ser una comunidad indígena, deberían tener unos tratos especiales, deberían tener unos tratos diferenciales, y el nivel de afectaciones a causa de las operaciones mineras es gigante.
I know that the Cerrejon mine has been involved in linked to the forced displacement of up to 35 indigenous and Afro-Colombian communities. Could you explain to us how are people forced to leave their homes? Is it through intimidation, for example? And what is the role in the Cerrejon mine in that? How do they orchestrate those forced displacements? Are the Colombian government or the police force also complicit in allowing that to happen?
En efecto, hay muchísimas investigaciones que así lo han determinado, pero también hay una suerte de verdades procesales, hay sentencias judiciales en el orden nacional que han determinado la responsabilidad de esta empresa en situaciones de desplazamiento forzado en nombre del desarrollo. Son muchísimas las prácticas y los patrones a través de los cuales se logra esta disputa y desplazan y despojan a las comunidades de sus tierras. Nosotros hemos logrado ver cómo en el tiempo hay ofertas, hay promesas, y frente a quienes se oponen a hacerle caso a las empresas y al mismo Estado, pues entonces estamos frente a unos casos en donde ha habido incluso salidas pues a través de la fuerza pública, y en efecto el Estado colombiano tiene también un grado de responsabilidad. Estamos frente a unas evidentes nociones de captura corporativa en todos sus dispositivos. Nosotros hemos logrado también percibir cómo las empresas se aprovechan de las comunidades y de las situaciones de vulnerabilidad en las que se encuentran. Hay una promesa del desarrollo, pero realmente esto es falso. Y hay también una práctica en la región de amenazas, de estigmatización, de persecución, que al momento pues, las autoridades colombianas no han investigado de fondo. La empresa Carbones del Cerrejón siempre ha manifestado estar en contravía de esas situaciones de amenazas, de riesgos, pero nunca ha reconocido que realmente por su actuar es que se están llevando a cabo determinados hechos que corresponde pues que se adelanten las investigaciones pertinentes.
I know that the Cerrejon mine has also been involved in environmental damage, which has led to human rights abuses, such as diverting streams and rivers in an already drought-prone area, dumping wastewater in the rivers, which has led to the buildup of heavy metals in the water, and also in emitting high levels of particulate pollution into the air that then causes respiratory problems and other health risks. And I understand that the Cerrejon mine were also ordered by a circuit judge to reduce their particulate emissions, and the Constitutional Court ordered them to restore a river, the Arroyo Bruno, to its original course. But those orders seem to have just been ignored. It seems like companies like the one responsible for the Cerrejon mine can just be above the law. I wonder how is it that companies can get away with ignoring court orders and failing to meet those required environmental standards?
La razón es la captura corporativa. La razón es el desconocimiento de múltiples sentencias que, como lo señalo, han declarado la responsabilidad de esta empresa. El problema gravísimo es que el Estado colombiano no ha hecho un efectivo seguimiento en la implementación de esas órdenes y en efecto, a pesar de las denuncias, de estas órdenes judiciales, del clamor y el llamado de las comunidades a que se respete el ambiente de este territorio, el bosque seco tropical, que se tenga en cuenta la crisis climática que atravesamos, a la empresa parece no importarle. Para las comunidades, realmente esta es una situación bastante delicada porque ponen sobre la vida del territorio y de ellos mismos los intereses económicos. No hay una atención a los llamados a los procesos de transiciones, no hay una atención a los llamados de la reparación integral que ya también en varias órdenes se han determinado. Hay una sensación de que realmente los derechos humanos y del ambiente no les interesan a estas empresas y que cada vez más se hacen necesarios pues políticas públicas, normas sobre la debida diligencia y que ya pasemos de la voluntariedad a realmente reclamar una responsabilidad por parte de estas empresas que tanto daño han hecho.
We're going to hear more from Rosa and Dave's conversation in a few minutes, but first I want to introduce you to Gary and Hannah and get some response from them to what has been discussed so far. So firstly, we have Hannah Story, who leads Frontline Defenders business and human rights work. Hannah works with defenders on business-related human rights abuses and is responsible for providing advocacy support to defenders at risk, as well as conducting research and working on policy development. Prior to joining Frontline Defenders, Hannah worked for the Forest Peoples Programme. And we have Gary Walsh, who leads Trocaire's policy and advocacy work on business and human rights. He has worked on a range of campaigns over the last 20 years. He has managed human rights and development programmes in Africa, Asia and the Middle East. He has previously overseen Trocaire's human rights programmes in Myanmar and Palestine and has worked for UNAIDS in Malawi. Hannah, if I can come to you first. Rosa shared with us about the communities being pushed off their land, about empty promises from the company, about community division and threats and intimidation, and that the authorities are not responding. Is this an isolated case, or do human rights defenders globally face similar challenges?
Thanks, Jeannie. And you already introduced me there, but I just wanted to mention very briefly what Frontline Defenders does, because I think that sort of frames where I'm coming from in this conversation. So Frontline Defenders is an organization which works to support human rights defenders at risk, meaning people who are persecuted because of their peaceful work for their rights or for the rights of others. And this is very much not an isolated case. We see human rights defenders all around the world who are impacted by businesses and mining, as in the case that Rosa was sharing there, is one of the most dangerous sectors for human rights defenders to speak out about. We also see that the practice of threats, of stigmatization and of persecution that Rosa talked about globally. For example, we see defenders speaking out about, you know, perhaps a company has come in and taken a community's land, or they've destroyed cultural sites, or perhaps they're not giving fair wages, or there's environmental impact. Companies polluting a local river or causing deforestation, for example. And when defenders speak out about these issues, that often leads to retaliation. And that retaliation can come directly from the company, but it also can come from other people who are around the company. So local people, local government, quite often it's local police or security forces. And the types of retaliations that we see defenders face really vary. They're very much along a spectrum. We often see that defenders face smear campaigns and stigmatization, and often in the context of business-related human rights abuses, that takes the form of calling them and framing them as anti-development in the media. We also see defenders face harassment or intimidation. So for example, you know, their offices or homes getting broken into, we see them unlawfully detained, We see legal cases taken out against them to keep them quiet, keep them busy in the courts. And sadly, at the extreme end of that, we do see violent attacks and killings. In 2020, the Human Rights Defender Memorial documented the killings of 331 human rights defenders. And that is the highest number in a decade, just over 6 defenders a week. And we do think that's probably an underestimation because there will be defenders who are killed in more remote locations who aren't necessarily sharing that information with us. So I just wanted to quickly share a case actually from a human rights defender that we were hoping would be able to speak today, but who wasn't able to join, but I'm hoping to share her case in her place. So Manuela from the member of the Defender Movement of Earth, Environmental Protection and Access to Water, or MODATIMA, which is a group in Chile that supports communities impacted by water scarcity in the Petorca province in Chile. And in this region, they're seeing widespread privatization of water and communities having little access to water, whereas the private sector has vast access to it for growing agricultural products. So Manu, when we spoke the other day, described seeing pools of thousands and thousands of liters of water for monoculture, and the people nearby having no water to drink, no water for their animals or for their farms. They're also seeing illegal pipes being put in to divert water to those plantations. Unfortunately, supermarkets in the UK are buying tons and tons of avocados from that region. And members of MODATIMA who are supporting communities in the region speaking out about this issue are facing criminalization, they're facing persecution, they're facing death threats, they've seen their cars burned, members have been attacked. So it is a really, you know, very, very dire situation. But this isn't about, you know, avocados or coal, you know, it's about all of the products that are coming into the UK and us wanting to be sure that they're not coming from these situations. So I don't want to just single out the avocado as the issue, but I think it's a really good case to demonstrate what's going on. And I just want to very quickly wrap up by reflecting on what Rosa said about the company distancing itself from attacks. Companies often say, oh, we're not involved in the attacks, and it's very difficult to prove that they are, of course. But even if they're not involved in the attacks, they're very much complicit in creating the situation which led to the attacks in the first place. So they're exploiting in the situation the water. People are speaking out about it, and it's creating that sort of perfect storm in which reprisals can happen. So the companies very much do have a responsibility here for reprisals. Anyway, I'll finish there, but thanks.
Thank you, Hannah. And Gary, can I just come to you for your response? Are there other examples globally of companies being involved in human rights abuse and environmental destruction?
Thanks, Jeannie. Yes, indeed there is. And I mean, my initial response, it's very powerful to hear from Rosa Maria about the situation in Colombia. And I think there's nothing like hearing the personal testimony of people on the ground like Rosa Maria. And I suppose I've been lucky, I've been privileged in my work with Trocaire to have traveled to many of the countries where Trocaire is working with communities affected by corporate abuse and exploitation. I've heard the personal testimony of communities in countries like Myanmar and Palestine, in Honduras and Kenya, people who have had their rivers poisoned by mining activities, who've had their land confiscated due to corporate activities, or indeed some who have lost family members who have been killed, who have been murdered, for the very act of standing up and defending their community's natural resources against corporate exploitation. And having heard these personal stories, it is very impactful, and you realize that these aren't just isolated cases. What's happening in Colombia is you know, it is shocking, and what we're hearing from Rosa Maria and the communities there, it is very shocking, but there are many, many more examples happening around the world, and we are all connected as well in today's interconnected global economy. It's not just a case of abuse happening in a country far away. Like, due to the interconnected nature of the global economy, we are connected in that the mobile phones in our pockets, the minerals and materials in our mobile phones, they may have been sourced by child labor in a mine in the Congo. And the fruits that we have, that we consume on a daily basis, they may be connected to labor rights abuses in Central America. The clothes that we wear could be connected to workers in garment factories in Southeast Asia, working very long hours, very unsafe conditions, not receiving a living wage. So we are all connected in this, and I think the issue of corporate abuse of human rights and the environment is one of the big human rights issues of our time. So it's great that we have this event today to be able to talk about these issues. Jeannie, you asked about other examples, and just to name a few of maybe the more stark examples, just wanted to show a few photographs. So the Rana Plaza disaster in 2013, some of you may be familiar with this. This photo shows the devastation that was caused when the five-story factory collapsed in Bangladesh. This was a factory that had that hadn't undergone adequate safety inspections. Over 1,000 people, mainly female garment workers, died when this factory collapsed in 2013. And this factory was largely being used to produce garments for Western companies. The likes of H&M and Primark were sourcing from this factory, which shows that these abuses, we often, Western companies aren't held liable for further down our supply chains. And we're sourcing from countries where there are weak protections of human rights. And this is one of the most stark examples. Another example that I'd like to speak to is Shell in the Niger Delta. Shell has been operating in Nigeria, in the Niger Delta, since the 1950s. An estimated 11 million barrels of oil have been spilled in the Niger Delta. And this has caused huge environmental devastation and destruction. This pollution has devastated the environment, but it's also affected people. It's affected people's livelihoods, their ability to grow crops, but it's also devastated their health. The statistics are shocking. An estimated 16,000 children die every year due to the pollution. The WHO estimates that the water is 900 times above adequate safety levels. And the life expectancy in the Niger Delta is 10 years lower than the rest of Nigeria, which is incredibly shocking, the impact this has on the planet, but also on people. Another example that I'd like to mention, and if we could just move on to the next photograph, please, is in the West Bank, where companies can be connected with issues of occupation and conflict. This photograph here is of a man named Ani Shaib. He's a Palestinian landowner. Behind him, you'll see there's an Israeli settlement built on confiscated Palestinian land, built on his land. And the company Airbnb, which many of you, I'm sure, know, it's a very popular platform for renting accommodation. This man went on to Airbnb in 2018 and saw that his land, you could, essentially anyone in the world could book a holiday on his confiscated land in this Israeli settlement, yet he cannot access his family's land in the settlement. And by generating profits off bookings in Israeli settlements, Airbnb is connected with the situation of conflict, with ongoing violations of international law. Another example I'd like to mention is of Tullow Oil, which is a company that is listed on the UK Stock Exchange, is initially an Irish company. This photograph, I took this in 2 years ago when I visited Turkana in northern Kenya, and I visited some of the indigenous communities here, and they were suffering from a drought. The region is very arid, and it is prone to droughts, largely, well, the climate change being one of the drivers of those droughts. And Tolo Oil is extracting oil in this area, and the consent of the local communities is in question. The free, prior, informed consent of communities has been disputed, and this lady that I met, she was adjacent to a road which has been built through communal land, and that land is traditionally used for the pastoralist way of life with herding goats. And this road and the oil installations has been built on communal land. And every day in the morning and the evening, this woman told me that she would see trucks rolling by full of crude oil as they were being transported to the Kenyan coastline. And she said to me that her community isn't seeing the benefits of this oil. And she was asking who is benefiting from this oil. And so this shows you these examples show some of the more stark situations that communities are facing, the inequality that this gets to the heart of in terms of who benefits from this rush for natural resources across the world, and also that companies from Ireland and from the UK are connected with this, and therefore we have a responsibility.
Thank you, Gary. So lots more to discuss with both of you shortly. But before we do that, we want to go back to the interview with Dave and with Rosa Maria and to find out more about how this issue is much closer to home than we initially think. Just a reminder as well, if you have questions, to drop them into the chat and we'll pick them up after this part of the interview.
And how is it that, how does Cajar go about supporting communities to hold powerful corporations like Cerrejon to account for their actions? And have you seen any particular outcomes of your efforts that give you hope to continue working on these issues?
El colectivo desarrolla unas estrategias junto con aliados y organizaciones que también trabajan en la región. Principalmente son estrategias concertadas y determinadas con las personas de las comunidades. Son estrategias que tienen en cuenta varias aristas, lo jurídico, el fortalecimiento organizativo, la incidencia, las comunicaciones, y sobre todo creemos en las comunidades cuando nos relatan sus hechos, y sobre esos relatos y sobre ese clamor a la justicia es que iniciamos nuestro trabajo. Realmente no es un trabajo fácil, si no fuera por organizaciones aliadas como Christian Aid y otras, nuestro trabajo sería muy difícil, porque además en nuestro país defender los derechos humanos y defender los derechos del territorio y ambientales no es una tarea fácil, y lamentablemente nos situamos en uno de los países más peligrosos para los liderazgos ambientales. Entonces por eso nuestras estrategias tienen que ir muy organizadas, atendiendo a muchísimas prácticas y sobre todo siempre con la verdad. Esa es nuestra mayor fortaleza, la verdad que recogemos de los territorios, la verdad que logramos corroborar cuando visitamos y cuando advertimos la situación pues tan peligrosa en la que se encuentran estas comunidades.
One of the reasons that Christian Aid Ireland has a particular interest in the Cerrejon mine is because the state-owned electricity supply board, the ESB, has bought coal from the Cerrejon mine to burn at the Money Point power station in County Clare, and also because the Cerrejon mine marketing company is based in Dublin, and it benefits from Ireland's lower corporation tax rate of 12.5%, potentially saving it millions of euro each year. What would you like to see corporations like the ESB and governments like Ireland and the UK doing to support human rights in Colombia, and also to challenge the power of corporations that are involved in these human rights abuses?
Nosotros creemos que estamos frente a una crisis ambiental, una crisis humana, que ese carbón que llega a Europa es un carbón pues manchado con sangre, con lágrimas, con mucho dolor. Y el mensaje específico para Irlanda es que ojalá pudieran de verdad considerar las propuestas que desde las comunidades están presentando. la necesidad de entablar una conversación y un diálogo sobre las transiciones justas. Es necesario evaluar cómo, a costa de ese dolor que están viviendo estas comunidades y la pérdida del ambiente, pues está llegando ese carbón a Europa y están teniendo estos réditos económicos que son necesarios evaluar porque justamente el planeta ya lo necesita. Y frente al último informe del panel de expertos en cambio climático, pues es una necesidad urgente el de evaluar para dónde va ese carbón, para qué es ese carbón y qué otros mecanismos de energías podemos empezar a evaluar en medio de esta crisis. Realmente estas empresas en nuestro país, insisto, han sido declaradas responsables de vulnerar derechos humanos. Y no es posible que las empresas en Irlanda pues, sigan teniendo relaciones con otras empresas que vulneran los derechos. Es necesario evaluar, investigar y, por supuesto, cerrar las vías a empresas que vulneran los derechos de manera tan atroz como lo es el caso de Carbones del Cerrejón y sus empresas Anglo American, BHP y Glencore.
What do you think that we can do as individuals to support human rights in Colombia and also to hold corporations to account?
Bueno, creo que la solidaridad con los pueblos a quienes se les están vulnerando sus derechos es necesaria. Nosotros invitamos a todas las personas a que sigan a través de las redes nuestras campañas. Hay una plataforma que se llama La Guajira le habla al país y en esa plataforma las personas pueden acompañar a las comunidades en sus luchas y en sus campañas de visibilización. Contarle al mundo lo que está sucediendo en La Guajira es urgente porque estamos en medio de una disputa por la verdad. Esa verdad donde claramente las comunidades son las que tienen la razón. Y es una disputa donde incluso embajadas, gobiernos de otros países han querido desvirtuarla o taparla. Y solo desde la sociedad civil es que hemos logrado tener esos apoyos para mostrar realmente lo que está ocurriendo y poder solicitar y exigir la responsabilidad frente a todo lo que está ocurriendo. Otra forma también de apoyar a estas comunidades y que es una responsabilidad para toda la humanidad es evaluar nuestro consumo. Realmente necesitamos la cantidad de energía que está sobrepasando las capacidades de nuestro planeta. Nosotros creemos que eso también es una responsabilidad que tenemos y por supuesto la exigencia a todos los gobiernos a que cumplan con los compromisos de descarbonización, a que cumplan con todos los compromisos en el marco del cambio climático, a que sean compromisos serios porque esta situación es urgente. Por ejemplo, en el caso Arroyo Bruno, nosotros hemos logrado tener un freno a la expansión minera y ese freno cada vez es más difícil cuando desde Europa y otros países señalan que van a seguir comprando carbón, que van a mejorar los precios y nosotros no entendemos eso. Si allá se está hablando de la urgencia de la descarbonización, ¿cómo insisten en que aquí se explote un territorio, se dañe la poca agua que hay en la región y se sigan vulnerando los derechos humanos de estas comunidades?
Rosa María, I just want to say thank you so much for taking the time to speak to us today. Really appreciate that. And I'm sure we'd all want to wish you every success in your continued work in Colombia and the really important work that you're doing there. So thank you very much for taking the time to speak to us today.
Thank you very much to Rosa, Maria and Dave. Christian Aid has published a report which looks at the relationship between the ESB, the Cerrejon mine in Colombia, and assesses whether Ireland is living up to its international human rights commitments. And you can find that report on the Christian Aid website. And so just, Gary, if I can come back to you, we've heard from Rosa Maria about how this case involves Ireland's state-owned electricity company and a Dublin-based marketing company. And it also involves the UK as the parent company which owns the mine is listed on the UK on the London Stock Exchange. And so what is the responsibility of Ireland and the UK in this case?
Thanks, Jeannie. So yes, as you've outlined, and Rosa Maria has mentioned, Ireland and the UK are connected to this case, particularly with the companies that you mentioned, ESB being the state-owned Irish energy company, CMC, the coal marketing company that's Dublin domiciled, and the mining giants, which are owners of Cerrejon, the mine, which is listed on the UK Stock Exchange. So, I mean, this all begs the question, why is a state-owned energy company importing a dirty fossil fuel, full stop, but from a notorious mine from Latin America? And why is it? Well, I suppose it's not against the law. It's not against the law for the ESB to be buying coal from a supplier. At present, the ESB isn't breaking the law. There aren't strong laws in place to prevent this from happening. So it may be a shocking question, but it is unsurprising when the law isn't fit for purpose to prevent these sort of human rights abuses, that human rights abuses will then occur. At present, there's a global framework under the UN Guiding Principles on Business and Human Rights, which outlines that corporations have a responsibility to respect human rights, and states have the responsibility to protect and uphold human rights. The problem is that the way that this framework is implemented is largely voluntary in nature. Essentially, it's up to companies like the ESB, like the mining giants listed on the UK Stock Exchange, it's up to them to police themselves. It's a voluntary system. And in today's interconnected global economy, this system is not fit for purpose. So a company that sources from a mine like Cerrejon can say, that's a different company, that's a supplier, it's a complex supply chain, not my responsibility. And they're not legally bound to assess the human rights issues and risks in the relationships they have, the commercial relationships and the supply chains that they have. So you have companies that have complex supply chains, that have complex networks, and they're not held responsible for what happened further down the chain. So the system we have at the moment, the global framework we have, and the legal framework that we have, is essentially not fit for purpose. And this is why we need to see new laws put in place. The voluntary system is not working. Now, this is not to say that all businesses are not responsible. Of course, there are responsible businesses out there. But the problem is that those who are not responsible, who do not want to behave ethically, are not forced to do so when the system is voluntary in nature, which is why we need stronger laws. So if the UK introduced a corporate accountability legislation, which would make it mandatory for companies listed on the UK Stock Exchange to undertake a process of human rights due diligence, and by that I mean that you would assess your supply chains, look at all of the companies that you are in your value chain, that are in your supply chain, assess them for risks. Do you know your value chain? Do you know that there's no sweatshop labor in your value chain? Do you know where the raw materials are being sourced from? Are you sure that there are no human rights violations or environmental damages happening? And at the moment, you're not required to know those things. So a lot of companies don't ask those difficult questions. They don't seek to know their supply chains and who they're actually working with. And as we see often, it's at the very end of the supply chain where the abuses happen. It's the communities that Rosa Maria has been talking about. They are the ones that are impacted by the worst abuses of human rights. So what we need is, we need the UK and the Irish government as well to introduce new laws that would make it mandatory, make it the law that these companies have to assess their supply chains, who they do business with, and respond if they do find out that there are human rights issues, respond to them, try and mitigate them, or just don't do business with those suppliers. So if we introduced laws which were meaningful and were robust, they would prevent these types of abuses from happening. If the Irish government had a law in place, then the ESB wouldn't, if it had done a meaningful and adequate due diligence process, it wouldn't have begun a relationship with the Cerrejon mine in the first place. So a law could be largely preventative in nature. But also it's important that when abuses do happen, that communities can access justice. At present, it's very difficult for a community who's affected by corporate abuse to take a case to seek damages against an Irish or UK company in courts in Ireland or the UK. So a really good law would not only try and prevent human rights abuses from happening, but would also give avenues for justice, for damages, for compensation, for remedy, if abuses still happen. So that's what we are, as a coalition of non-governmental organisations, that's what we are campaigning for. We'd like to see the UK and Ireland introduce robust laws. Thanks.
Thanks, Gary. And Hannah, if I could just come to you then, what would a law like this, how would this offer protection to human rights defenders?
Thank you. And first of all, just to echo support for what Gary just said there, we're very much aligned in terms of what we're looking for here. This is just a little bit more detail, I suppose, as we're looking at this sort of particular angle. So if there were a law that looked a little bit like Gary was saying, we would want to see explicit recognition of risks of reprisals and asking companies to look at risks to human rights defenders throughout their supply chains and look, therefore looking at how they could mitigate those risks. So for example, companies could have a sort of zero tolerance statement about reprisals with defenders and ensuring they're communicating that throughout their supply chains. And again, as Gary said just there, stopping using suppliers where reprisals are occurring or where companies aren't responding well to allegations of reprisals. Because as I mentioned earlier, it's very difficult to prove that a company has been involved in a reprisal, but they should also be responding well when a reprisal occurs and not worsening the risk for human rights defenders. So this is the first thing. But the other element we're really keen to see in a law on human rights due diligence is something that asks companies to meaningfully and safely engage with communities. And this is because we see that many reprisals actually stem from a lack of engagement. So in 2020, the Business and Human Rights Resource Centre documented just over 600 attacks of defenders working on business-related human rights abuses. And they found that just over a third of those actually stemmed from a lack of meaningful consultation with those human rights defenders. So it is a key factor. And to illustrate that case, I wanted to share quickly the case of Fikeli Nutshangazi from South Africa, who you can see now a picture of her there. She was sadly killed in October 2020 after opposing the extension of one of South Africa's largest open coal mines. And one of the things that she was campaigning on was really around the lack of public consultation, which led to the planned extension of that mine being on the community's ancestral lands. There was no consultation, there was certainly no consent. And when Fikeli and other community members refused to move for this extension, there was a significant amount of violence, and that sadly led to the killing. And this mine was initially funded by the International Finance Corporation, which is part of the World Bank Group and in part funded by the UK. So we think it's really crucial that investors are also obliged to look at their human rights impacts. And just to finish up, I think although we want companies to engage with communities and with human rights defenders to see what the risks are to them, we also think it's really crucial for companies to engage in order to effectively understand what their human rights impacts are. If an investor or the IFC or a company had gone to Fekeli and the rest of the community and spoken with them about the issues, they would have been highlighted before the killing happened. So as Gary said earlier, this is very much about prevention of reprisals for us. We really think this, having a law on human rights due diligence is crucial for preventing reprisals. Thanks.
Thank you, Hannah. And thank you to everyone who's been sending in questions on the chat. So we now have some time to get to some of those. So Gary, I'll just start with you. There's a few that has come in here on a common theme around consumers. Consumers wanting more information, questions on whether or not we should boycott certain companies, questions around a blacklist where there's a name and shame as well. And so just any reaction to things like that. And I suppose the power of consumers and having that information, what we should do with it.
Thanks, Jeannie. Yeah, good questions. When it comes to consumerism, ethical consumerism and boycotting individual companies, I have a bamboo toothbrush. I don't buy peanut butter that has palm oil in it, if possible. I try not to buy products from Israeli settlements. I'm one of those people. But all that being said, I don't think gross violations of human rights should be a matter of consumer choice. I think it's more important than that. I think it can be very empowering to buy products and pressure companies and to not be connected with something that you believe is unethical. Absolutely. I also think that some targeted boycott campaigns can be very effective, and they can, I think, when they're well organized, change the practice of individual companies through naming and shaming. But they take a lot of effort to change just the behavior of one company. And often that behavior, the change mightn't be sustainable. So I think it has its limits. And I think what we're talking about here in terms of introducing legislative frameworks could be far, far more powerful and more far reaching. So instead of the responsibility being on you, the consumer, the responsibility is on the company. The company that is connected with human rights violations, the government that doesn't regulate those companies, that's where the responsibility, I think, really lies. And I think if we did have our governments accept that responsibility and put in a level playing field for business and regulate business, that could have a really far-reaching impact across systematically for all businesses, and could have a huge preventative effect on human rights violations. So if there's one thing I would ask people to go away from today's talk is not necessarily to boycott ESB or boycott a specific company. If you're going to do one thing, don't buy a bamboo toothbrush. Write to your representatives, write to your elected representatives, lobby your government, because that systematic change could be much, much more impactful. And I know that the organizations involved today, Trocaire, but as well as Frontline and Christian Aid, have been involved in campaigning on this issue. There are many reports out there, there are documentaries, there are resources, and there are going to be some petitions being launched in the coming weeks. I know the Corporate Justice Coalition in the UK are going to be launching a petition calling for the sort of law that myself and Hannah have been outlining here. And I think it would be great for people to sign up to that petition. Down south in the Republic of Ireland, there's a new coalition, the Irish Coalition for Business and Human Rights. We'll be launching a new campaign and a new report in the coming weeks, and there'll be a petition going around. So, look at our social media channels, check out our websites. There's going to be a lot of materials. It'd be great if you can take action. It'd be great if you can get your friends to take action, share on your social media, talk about this at dinner parties. We need to get people to really care about this issue, and I think, to really focus efforts on changing the government and trying to get systemic change.
Thank you, Gary. And Hannah, maybe a question for you is around COVID-19 and restrictions related to it, and what has the impact been on human rights defenders, especially in related to business?
Thank you. Good question. It's been incredibly difficult for human rights defenders this past sort of 18 months, making it incredibly difficult for human rights defenders to continue their work, particularly due to lockdowns and things like that, which is particularly galling as many companies have continued to operate throughout. So where defenders have really struggled to keep up their work, although of course they have, but it has been a real challenge. We've also seen the difficulty of security options where human rights defenders are being asked to stay in place, and perhaps their security relies on them moving around when they're under threat, for example. That has been incredibly difficult. We've also seen a huge number of human rights defenders who are in jail at particular risk of COVID-19. We've seen people being denied temporary release, access to medical care, PPE. Sometimes we've seen human rights defenders deliberately exposed to the virus, so it's been particularly awful. We have also seen companies using the pandemic as an excuse to let go labour rights defenders or union leaders, which has been particularly bad. And sadly, you know, as I mentioned the statistics earlier on killings of human rights defenders, the killings have continued or even increased. So it has been a tough year, although human rights defenders continue to be innovative and really at the forefront of this fight. So I don't want to just highlight the negatives there, but it's certainly been a challenge and continues to be a challenge.
Thank you. And many of the examples that we've heard today of human rights defenders, they're women human rights defenders. And so do women face particular, or are they at particular risk for their work in this area?
Yeah, definitely. There's an extra layer of misogyny and marginalization that women human rights defenders face. They're more likely to experience gender-based discrimination, sexual harassment and violence. They're also more likely to experience smear campaigns, according to our data, and toxic online abuse. I think that's common for a lot of women on social media, but particularly for women human rights defenders. And then, of course, there's extra barriers to the work if they're having to uphold kind of more traditional domestic work or caring responsibilities, which, again, you know, has been exacerbated by the pandemic, people being at home. And sometimes they have less access to decision-making spaces, that they're even less likely to be consulted by companies, going back to the meaningful consultation piece that I mentioned earlier. But again, I wouldn't want to end, you know, completely on a negative note. As you said, Jeannie, women really are at the forefront of this. And the women of Modatima, who I mentioned earlier on, are just really inspiring, taking on that work. They very much see women as being central for the fight for water security in the region, and actually as part of caring work. So they're not seen as separate. They're very much at the forefront, and many women human rights defenders are.
Fantastic, thank you, Hannah. And I suppose, so time is going against us, but we do have time for one more question, which you've actually led into very well. And it's just, it's easy, I suppose, to be disillusioned whenever you're faced with the gravity of the injustice or the scale of the problem that communities like Rosa Maria's face. And so what inspires you that change can happen? And Hannah, if I just go back to you, and then I'll get Gary to respond.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, speaking with human rights defenders is what motivates me in my work every day. The fact that they continue despite threats, despite knowing the risk, because they know what's right, is just incredibly inspiring. And yeah, as I say, motivates me every day. But I also, you know, are motivated by moments like this, speaking with the public who, you know, are supportive. I think people do want businesses to do the right thing, to be responsible in terms of human rights and the environment. So yeah, I hold that with me throughout this work, certainly.
And Gary?
Yeah, I suppose that there are a few things, but one thing that would give me hope is that, you know, when we talk about governments taking action, I actually feel that there's hope, that there's momentum, and that we're moving away from, hopefully we're moving away from corporations policing themselves, voluntary measures, and we're moving now towards governments starting to take action. Like France introduced a law on supply chains a few years ago, Germany introduced a law this year, so did Norway. The EU is now looking at an EU directive. The UN, there's discussions on a UN treaty. It feels like there is momentum towards, you know, a new paradigm where governments take this seriously and regulate companies. Now there's challenges, and there's a big corporate pushback, and you know, there's threats to laws that could be watered down, and I think that's where people power comes in, and people campaigning can really you know, help us deliver laws that are effective and that ultimately protect the communities on the ground. So I take hope that, yeah, we might hopefully be entering a new phase.
Thank you. Unfortunately, that's all we have time for today. Just before we finish, we wanted to let everyone watching know that Frontline Defenders would love your feedback on today's event. So there's going to be a link posted into the chat, which is to your short survey, and it would be fantastic if you could just take a few minutes to complete it. We'd really appreciate it. A very special thank you to Rosa Maria for sharing her story with us. We continue to stand in solidarity with Rosa Maria and her community in their struggle for justice. Thank you to Gary and to Hannah for their contributions. Thank you to everyone within Christian Aid, Frontline Defenders in Trocaire, and the One World Festival who made this event possible. And finally, thank you to all of you for joining us. Don't forget to check out the One World Festival website to find out what's coming up this afternoon and evening on the last day of the festival, or to watch back at the exciting events that happened earlier in the week. Thank you.
Thanks, Jeannie.
Thanks very much.